Good evening, and welcome to the May 9th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Board. If we could all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have adjustments to the agenda. I have one adjustment. Under school report number 9, a request to move that up to after 5, which would be comments from the public on non-agenda items. Does anyone else have any other additions?
The only thing that I would add is, under recognition, you have the North Shore Science League competition. And you have a teacher and some students here tonight who would speak at that point in time.
Okay.
So we can stay in the same place because it's right after, almost right after the other report.
All right. Those adjustments. Thank you. Approval of the April school board minutes. They are included in your packet. Can I have a motion to accept them as presented?
So moved.
Thank you. Second? Thank you, Rebecca. Any comments or observations? Being none, all those in favor? 7-0. Great, thank you. Comments from our student representatives. Do we have any members of the high school representatives here this evening? Oh, they do?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you. How about some middle school representatives? Ah, I see Jack.
He's here.
Yeah.
My partner actually isn't here. I think he had a lacrosse game.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be, there's not really many announcements for the 7th and 8th grade, so mainly the 5th and 6th. To start things off, the Cape's 6th grade left for Chewonki on Monday. Last week was Spirit Week, and we had different days with different categories for each day, like Pajama Day, Clash Day, Be Your Favorite Person Day. At the end of the day, prizes were given out to one boy and one girl from each grade, and the two winners were given, a prize. Coming up on May 19th, possibly, is a walkathon to help benefit cancer research. Student council members will be going to a track in Brunswick and will walk in shifts around the track throughout the night. And the 8th grade is having a community service week for the Cape Land Trust, and we've been building bridges in muddy areas near the Dyer Hutchinson trails. That's it.
Anyone have any questions for Jack?
Just a comment. I think the Land Trust, that community service program is great, and I think we owe a thank you to the Land Trust personnel who've been there morning after morning working there. I was there this morning, and there's four or five people from the Land Trust who are helping out. So thank you to the Land Trust volunteers who are doing that as well, and to the 8th grade students.
Thank you. At this point, I'll take comments from the public on non-agenda items for this evening. Okay, I don't see anyone coming to speak, so we'll move along to number 9, which was the school report. And this evening, I would like to welcome Mark Pendarvis and some of his students who will be making a presentation on their exchange with a community in Costa Rica.
Thank you. Is this the microphone?
Yeah.
Back when we started this, I believe it was fall of last year. I don't know when it was, maybe spring of last year, Kevin Sweeney asked us. The one thing he requested was that we bring something back. So this is the something back that we're bringing after the entire exchange. We'll get the technologies up there. This is part of the annual technology update. What we'll do tonight is I'll show you a slideshow of some of the things from the time that they came here. We had a group of Costa Rican students come here. I think there were 14 of them came here in January, one of our warmest months. And the next day we took them tubing, and you remember the weather in January. There was one week where we had something like 10 below. I think that was the day that we chose to go tubing with our Costa Rican friends. And I'll show you the slideshow and mention some things as we go on here. And then I have a couple of students who would like to say a few things about it, who went with me. I've got the captions up at the top. So there's our Costa Rican teacher, Jose Luis Corrales. They came in January. They arrived early. In Costa Rica, December to January is their time off. This is what it looked like for them. Costa Rica does not look like this. I have to stop this here because this is one of the more interesting events. The kids were at Best Buy, and they were wondering how to get to Target, and somebody pointed across the way. So as you can see, they are now crossing I-95 on foot. They ran ahead of their teacher. When they got to the other side, of course, the state police were there. It was quite an eventful day for all of our Costa Rican friends. The kids were happy. The teacher was a little frazzled. But they all made it. This is the teacher with his Goodwill jacket in front of our national landmark, actually our town landmark. While they were here, they had this group, more than any other student group that I've ever had, really bonded together. We didn't have one personality conflict that I can think of. They just all really got together and bonded quite well. This is a typical Costa Rican meal. It's called gallo pinto. They eat it with everything, and they made it for one of the get-togethers we had here. While they were here, we also took them to Boston, and we went on a skywalk. It was a cold day, meeting some friends in Boston there. That's, again, the teacher. They took us on some trips as well when we were down there. It was a wonderful reciprocal arrangement. This is Jose Luis in front of Cape Elizabeth High School again. And this is all the kids. These are all the Costa Rican kids that came. I think there were 14 of them, I'm pretty sure. They also spent some time in the middle school. They visited all the middle school and the elementary school classes. We split the kids up, and they spent, I think, 2 or 3 days over in the middle school in Pond Cove Elementary. It was a thrill for all the kids over there. This is Jose Luis here at the high school. We had a little reception afterwards, before and after, and then this is the final goodbye. I don't have a lot of class shots from here at Cape Elizabeth High School. Kids have more of that in their repertoire. This was a very tearful goodbye. And then we went down there. This is the welcome party they had for us out at a farm in Costa Rica, and all of the kids that stayed with families here went and stayed with families there. These are the parents. They were wonderful, absolutely wonderful. Very hospitable. That's Daly's backyard. We got there actually in Holy Week, and they had a week off. So what happened was we landed, we all went to different families, and then I didn't see the kids for a week because all the families during Holy Week, they do different things. So everybody took off to wherever their family was going. Some people went to the beach, some people stayed in town in Guapiles. Daly went to the volcano Arenal. I went to Puriscal. But they all have my phone number and a cell phone number. This is what happens during Holy Week. They have these processions in all the towns. This is the town that I was in. They have these reenactments, the passion plays. And this is one of the, I think Heather, you went to one too, in Cartago. Then when we got back, they planned an event for us. This is called Tortuguero. It's a place in Costa Rica where there's no roads. You have to take canals in. Those are the buses.
in, and we went in there for one evening in Tortuguero. It's a national park. It's absolutely unbelievable. Rainforest. We saw alligators. Incredible place. This was Rita. Rita was one of the best moms that we had there. She married an American, and so she didn't speak any English. And Jim spoke very interesting Spanish. He had a very heavy North Carolina drawl. Rita, ¿dónde está? But she did a lot of the cooking for us here in the Tortuguero. There's Heather posing over there. And then we left. Again, there's no roads into this place. And you see, it's a rainforest. There's trees that go 100 feet up, all kind of flora, fauna. This is the school that we're in. The school is called the Green Valley School, Centro Educativo Green Valley. It's based on learning English, so they have some subjects in English, like math and sciences. It's got a religious tone to it. This is Jose Luis, the teacher here. Every Tuesday morning, he leads all the elementary school in the Pledge of Allegiance, the national hymn, Our Father, another prayer, and then a creed about I will be a good student and a good boy, and this is a good thing to do. It takes about a half hour. It's kind of neat. These are the, the school day lasts till about 3:20. They have four breaks during the day. This is one of the breaks. There's one of our students, and Gina Stevenson, and Eric Castillo. His dad, or his uncle, owns like the Home Depot there. That's a typical classroom. They don't have a whole lot in the classrooms, but they do have books, and there's me. I'm explaining Maine and how cold it is. And a lot of the kids, I asked them, do you have relatives here in the States? And a lot of Costa Ricans are in New Jersey, Patterson, New Jersey, Trenton, New Jersey, and then in North Carolina. If you ever go to Hilton Head, you'll find that a lot of the folks who work in the hotels there are Costa Ricans. These were my little friends. I was having coffee one day, and one little girl came up, hugged me, sat down, and the rest of them joined her. This is Gina in one of the classrooms. Our students spent time in the classrooms, and I gave them some time also to get caught up with their capabilities of schoolwork here. And then we sent them down to the elementary school to play games. I think this was Duck, Duck, Goose, Goose, or something like that. Jose Luis, the teacher that came here, he's kind of a semi-administrator in his school. He's responsible for scheduling and so forth. This is kind of neat. Now, if you know anything about South America, Latin America, we were in Guapiles, Costa Rica. And this railway was the railway that was constructed by the Miner family, United Fruit Company. That's the actual railway. And all these towns in the Caribbean coast were built like that along the railway system. Very different from most Spanish towns in Latin America. Most of them are built around a plaza. But this is part of what we call today the Banana Republics. This was very interesting. It's all interesting, but I'll run through this slideshow quick. Notice the latex gloves and the gym shorts. This is the senior class project for fundraiser. The senior class raises about 40 to 45 chickens. And when the chickens are fully grown, the senior class comes in their gym clothes with their latex gloves, and they butcher their chickens, scald them, pluck them, and wrap them to be delivered to the families that have purchased them. I think that would be a fine senior class project. But it was a whole different experience and a different country. This is San Jose, Costa Rica. There was a big soccer game between La Liga and Saprissa, two of the main teams. The kids, whoever's family they were staying with, they kind of had a rivalry. The Costa Ricans also planned an aerial tram. This is a 2-mile aerial tram over the rainforest. We had a guide, a biology master. Master's degree, usually, or they're working towards a biology master's degree, and they explained to us the plants. Addison Everett was touching plants as he was going. The guy said, don't do that. You might die, because there's poisonous snakes that crawl up those plants. And then in the same area, we had these zip lines, which are pretty popular in Costa Rica. They have these cables that are set across trees. And that's another... the families planned so much for us. They planned another trip that we took with the kids down a rapids, a class 4 rapids, near an Indian reservation. They really did get exposed to a whole lot, and I can't express how much they did hospitality-wise for us. It's just kind of the way it is. This is the goodbye party. This is Jim's house. He's an American that went down there, bought 120 acres, and lives and does all kinds of interesting things down there. That's my daughter, Paige. She came down with me. She's in the 8th grade, so she'll have stories to tell. This is the goodbye speech. Notice the Cape Elizabeth staff shirt, appropriate for the day. And then this is Felix and Heather. They kind of gave the goodbye speeches for the kids that were there. They also had karaoke. Karaoke is very big in Costa Rica, and so is dancing. They dance very well. There's Mike. He's very excited about being in school. In Costa Rica, the teachers move around. The students don't. So you can be with the same group of kids for 4 years, and they don't move. The teachers move. So they get to be very, very close to students. This is Don Farid. He's the principal. This is Rita, I think her name was, too. She owns the school. She and her husband own the school. And then that's the Joanne Moriarty right there, Flory. When we left, they did this wonderful, they called it an acto civico, a civic act. And they lined us all up, and they had all the students there. They gave a little speech, and then they presented us with little gifts for the exchange. Those are the little gifts. They're wooden carved notepads that they gave us as gifts in leaving. And that's the final day. We were very lucky with the weather, because it's supposed to be the rainy season. The final day we were there, it came down, cats and dogs, and it doesn't stop from here on out, about 2 months. It just rains and rains and rains. It's very humid. There's all the girls that were there, both the Costa Rican girls and the American girls. Everybody really, really had a good time, number one, and they learned a lot from both sides. They were exposed to things that you just can't teach in classrooms. There's the sign for the Green Valley School. And then upon leaving, the final day, they planned a field trip for us, and they took us to two different places, this beautiful park that's world-renowned. It's in the background over there. The man that did that park has also done the gardens at Buckingham Palace and the Vatican. So we went to that park, and we threw our suitcases on the bus while we were doing the field trip. Then they put us in a smaller bus, and we went back to our hotel, where we flew out the next day from San Jose. That's the Caribbean side. We were on the Caribbean side of Costa Rica. There's three mountain ranges that run through Costa Rica. And of course, this is everywhere. There's a couple of interesting things we learned while we were there. Walmart bought out the three largest supermarket chains in Costa Rica. So guess what we're going to see down there pretty soon. There's a native. That's Addison Everett. And we're very sad to go. That's Daily there. It was both times that we left, it was very sorrowful party. Of course, there we are. CVS Pharmacy in the Kilcoshire, Jose Luis and I. He is absolutely a wonderful teacher. And that's our final shot at the hotel before we left. So, there we go. So thank you very much. And I've got a couple of students that would probably like to say a few things. All right.
We'll thank Mr. Pendarvis in a little while, but it was all thanks to him that we got to go, and we really appreciate it, because it was so much more than a vacation, you know, everyone else. So I'm going to the Bahamas for April vacation, or I'm going to Florida, and like going to Costa Rica was just so much more than that, because we really got to live with the families and understand what their life is like. And I mean, it's pretty similar in the way that, you know, houses, school, parents and stuff like that, but it was the minor things that you learn about other people and their cultures that was just really fascinating. And being there for 2.5 weeks didn't even seem enough to really get immersed, but it really gave us a taste of what it would be like to live in a different country. And how different everything is, and it was just really fun. The family showed us so much stuff. We all got to go to different places, like the beach and the volcanoes and...
School.
And we saw a lot of churches and the religious processions. It was just really interesting and stuff that we don't focus on in the United States. There are different values and stuff like that. It was just really different, so... Good. I think you said it.
Oh, come on.
We got Mr. Pendarvis a little thank you for everything he did, so not everyone signed it yet, but this is for you. It's a group picture. Oh, everyone signed it, so we would like to thank you on behalf of everyone involved in the Costa Rican Exchange. We want to express to you how much we admired, appreciated, and highly respected your knowledge, responsibility, kindness, and guidance that you so graciously shared with us on the trip. The exchange gave us the amazing opportunity of stepping outside of the classroom and putting our Spanish to use in households where in most cases no one spoke any English. Beyond the chance to practice our Spanish, being immersed into the culture, customs, and daily lives of the Costa Rican people was an opportunity that is hard to find. Brought us outside the boundaries of Cape Elizabeth, of Maine, and of the United States. Being able to experience all of these things has intrigued us to see what else there is out there in the world for us to explore, learn about, and fall in love with as we did Costa Rica. And all of this learning we have done, we give you credit for. Thank you so much for your effort and coordination in making this exchange possible, and we'll see you next year.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I'd just like to say, Mark, my daughter was a beneficiary of your trip, and I just was so impressed with the stories that she told when she came home and the opportunity that she had, and I just encourage any of our teachers and all of our students to take advantage of something like this, and really appreciate the dedication and bravery it took to take 11 Cape Elizabeth students down there for 2.5 weeks. And if anyone has any questions for Mark or the students at this time, they could tell you some stories.
Well, I'd like to thank, first of all, I'd like to thank you guys for this. This is a great gift. And I'd also like to thank the school board for allowing us to take the time off during the school year to be able to go down there and do this. They'll walk away with things that you just can't learn, and it will stick with them forever. One of the stories I told down there was... that I was talking to the students was, it's like a monument that's built somewhere in your mind. And you don't see a monument in a plaza every day, but every time you drive by, you know, like Monument Square downtown, it's always there, and it's always a recognition of an accomplishment of something historical. So, again, thank you for everything.
Okay, thanks. Let's move on to communications. Alan?
The first thing I've given you is a brief memo from Mary Jane Call, who is our licensed psychologist.
I'm sorry. Didn't you have one more thing you wanted to add on right after the Costa Rican trip for the science?
No, we're going to do that under recognition. It's coming right up.
Sorry. Quickly. Okay. I saw widened eyes.
Yeah.
So
no, we're going to move very quickly.
It'll be
there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what I have presented to you this evening is Mary Jane's request for 12 weeks of maternity leave. She's expecting twins, first children. So I brought it today mainly because although she's looking at coming back in September, we are also very much aware that might not happen. And so I brought this mainly for information because she is contracted services to us. But just so you are well aware that this is going to be happening and that I do need to get approval for her maternity leave.
Okay. You want to vote for an approval. Okay, do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation on accepting the
12-week maternity leave. September, in October.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, Trish. Any questions regarding this? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
The second document that you find in your packet is on the writing program at Pond Cove Elementary School. 16 of us had an opportunity to do a walkthrough at Pond Cove to visit four classrooms apiece. We're in groups of two. As a superintendent, I was very pleased to have that opportunity to do it along with other administrators and staff. This report, written by Cyrene Wells, she was a consultant hired from Heinemann to do this. If you've had a chance to read it, you will find that she saw some wonderful things going on there. She had some suggestions. And Tom, I don't know if you'd like to speak to this just briefly about what it does say, tell us about what went on.
You're probably well aware that we're now in the second year of our writing program. And I think we knew we were doing internally, so through the generosity and support of CEEF, we were able to hire an outside consultant who works for the company that published the materials we use. Serene's report both confirmed we're on the right track, and then it had some questions and challenges for us, like to get focused more and to make sure that we articulate our philosophy more clearly and relate our assessment, notably our report card, more clearly to our writing program. So it's something we wanted to get done, and it worked out with the walkthrough at the same time. So it's supportive and challenging at the same time. It was a great thing to do. I also want to thank Alan for joining the walkthrough. Gave up a day of his life to do that. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And finally, what I have under communication is just a reminder to all of you and the public that on Monday, May 15th, there is a town council meeting where they will determine their finances for the 2006-2007 school year. I certainly encourage everyone to attend, to hear the discussions. I'll remind you as a board, you have gone into those discussions at a 6.95 budget. There is a 3.4 spending cap, and so we will see that evening where the budget process does go. But I do remind you it's at 7:30 on the 15th right here in these chambers. And that's all I have at this point on communications.
Thank you. We have a few recognitions this evening, and I may take them a little bit out of order and then go with the fourth one because we have a presentation by the North Shore Science League competition. First, I'd just like to take a moment and have recognition for some Pond Cove students who recently came back from the Maine State Scholastic Chess Championships. And I am proud to say that we have a second grader who was the K through, he was the K through 3 state champion in chess, and his name was Matthew Fishbein. In addition to that, for the age group K through 6, there was a 10-player team that was entered from community services, and they came in second overall in the state. And they missed first place by simply a half a point. So again, congratulations to Matthew Fishbein. Other members of the larger team were Tommy Brett, also in second grade. I'm going to struggle with some of these last names, but I apologize. Jack Demeter, Matthew Real Haddam, Danny Brett, Ethan DuPere, Brett Parker, Alex Silva, and Peter Campbell. And I just also like to add that Peter Campbell came in second in the state in individuals in the K through 6 grade level. So, gosh, I'm just really impressed that they're playing chess at that age and coming out as state championships. So congratulations. I'd also like to recognize the achievement of Kinsey Tarbell from our high school. She's a high school writer who recently was named one of the 8 semifinalists in the Governor's Young Writer of the Year Award. She had a short story entered by her teacher, Matt Clements, called Memories, and it was will be submitted and will go before a panel made up of Linda Greenlaw, Richard Russo, and Wesley McNair, and the final award will be to the top 3 out of the 8, and they'll receive $2,500. So we do wish Kinsey good luck and appreciate her efforts. And lastly, the North Shore Science League competition. At the high school, we have a science team, and they recently went into their first competitive situation, I understand, down at the North Shore Science League, and they came in third place. But we also have 3 students this evening, and I'll have Mr. Garrett introduce them, and they have a demonstration of, I believe, what came in first place. So welcome, Sean, and students.
Thanks. Actually, I've got a little handout for you guys.
Thanks. Golf ball, sorry.
Last year, we came up before you guys, and I think you remember we asked for funding. We want to thank you sincerely for funding us, and we're not here to ask for any more. We're just here to give you an update on what we've done with that funding. And so I gave you guys a handout that gives you the highlights of the year, and there's a couple things I'm really proud of. First of all, participation was really good this year. We have up to 30 students this year competing in events in both the different leagues we're competing in, which is a doubling of our membership, which is quite a jump in 1 year. In the main science Olympiad, we made quite a leap. I think you may remember last year we came in 7th out of 13. That was our first year. This year we captured 4th out of 15th. So we made quite some progress. Our students are getting very good. They're starting to learn how to compete in this league. I was very impressed with that. And then the North Shore Science League, which you guys approved last year. Again, this is a league in Massachusetts. There are currently 30 teams in this league. Science. In that league, we had quite a year. We came in, as you said, third out of 30 teams. There are 6 meets throughout the year, 3 events at each meet. Of those 6 meets, we won 2 out of 6 meets, first place out of 30 teams. And very impressive, out of the 18 individual events, 5 first place finishes. Again, 30 teams in each of those, which is just incredible. They did a fantastic job. I'd like to take credit for this, but the truth of the matter is I'm really just the glorified taxi driver. These guys are doing it on their own. They're designing these. This beautiful device is theirs. This is all their work. I'd like to, before we get to that competition, I'd like to give credit to a couple people first of all. We had a couple wonderful captains this year that really were behind the success. Our senior captains were Alice Evans and Isabel Mullen. They're a fantastic job. Our junior captains were Dan Shedd and Liam Sullivan. And our sophomore captains were Charlie Governale, Libby Cummings, and Morgan Alden. And this group of people really held it together and pulled it together and did a fantastic job this year. On to the demo. Okay, so all we handed to you guys was actually an event description. If you'll look right here, I am the person. As I explained last year, the North Shore Science League, what makes this league so interesting is the coaches develop the events. So we are responsible to host an event each year. I'm proud that this event was mine. The challenge to this event was...
There's a microphone for you right there.
Is it working for me? Is this working?
Yeah, let me just turn it
off. Okay. Is it working? All right, it is. Okay, so the goal of this was to build a device that would separate wiffle balls from regular golf balls. The device had to have a loading container, which interestingly is what most teams got stuck on. That most of these loading containers would actually jam up as soon as you started them.
We noticed the balls were getting stuck, as many other groups did, and we understood that we needed to agitate the whole loading bin so that the balls would bounce off each other and then come out in single file. And the way we did that was we took an electric sander from Thomas's basement. We kind of... kind of just took all the stuff out of Tom's basement one night, like the Sunday night before it was due. And we were all just sitting there not really doing anything, and we decided we should probably start on it. And we just got all the tools, and the sander proved to work very well. Other than that, there wasn't any tough part of the project, so.
There was a second part that was a little bit challenging. Obviously, once you get them out single file, you have to separate them. And what these guys came up with is absolutely ingenious. They simply used air, and as you'll see, this is the device that actually won it all. It separated all their golf balls very successfully. I like the name of the people who were on this. This is Michael Curtis, Matt Homa, and Tom Barker. And these guys, again, this was actually an event that the teams were very excited for, and I can honestly tell you, the team showed up and tried to compete in this one. These guys did a fantastic job and really deserve a lot of credit. They beat some really strong schools, and you guys want to show them how it works?
Yeah, obviously we told you about the sander already, and we knew that the real meatballs, I mean golf balls, would travel and not get blown by the wind, so we knew that setting up fans would blow the lighter ones this way, so. Didn't work as well now as it did at the competition, but we successfully sorted 20 plastic golf balls from the regular golf balls, and I think, 23 seconds. And out of the 30 teams, only our team and another team sorted them perfectly. And theirs took 2 minutes, so we pretty much excelled in this, so we're pretty happy.
Well, great. Thank you for coming. That was great to have a demonstration of how you won first prize. So give yourself more credit. It was great. I'll just take a minute and let them disassemble. Trish, under recognition, we have recognition of some Pond Cove parents, and I thought if you could talk to that, that would be great.
There were several parents who took the concept of Teacher Appreciation Week above and beyond, I think, this year. All the parents' associations do a great job with that, but this year at Pond Cove, there were several parents or a group of parents who undertook the redecoration and cleaning of 10 faculty bathrooms at Pond Cove. And the coordinators of this project, I will list them by name. This list does not include the painters and all the other people who helped pull it off, so thank you to those people as well. But these people planned, painted, cleaned, stenciled, you name it. They literally spent, aside from the planning, Friday night through Sunday night on this project. And those people are Sarah and Ron Spidell, Susan and Steve Kelly, Chris and Jen Jones-Spann, Lee Wilson, Jane Parker, Laura Lee Scheidel, Audrey Castro, Pauline Doan, Lynn Blank, and Margaret and Richard Robinson. So I think it was a great job. And if you haven't been over there to see the, I told them they should have taken before and after pictures because it was quite a change. So thank you to those people.
It's a great touch. Which brings me to our last recognition, which is that fact that today is May 9th. And I just wanted to say that it's quite fortuitous and basically timely, but today is National Teacher Day. While we'd like to take this opportunity to pause and thank our teachers, I encourage both parents and students, both past and present, to also share their thoughts and appreciation throughout the whole week. When Henry Adams wrote, "A teacher affects eternity, he can never tell where his influence stops," he expressed a sentiment that any student could share. Teachers help us to not only learn how to read, write, count, but how to study, think on our own, and to remember that learning is lifelong and enjoyable. By words and actions, teachers impart moral and civic values, and during our most formative years, our teachers help us understand ourselves and the world around us. Few other professionals touch as many people as teachers do. National Teacher Day is a good time for us all to learn about the contributions educators make to our community. As a community, we all have to work together to help make our teachers even more successful. Parents, retirees, government, and students must work together. Public schools are at the heart of any community. When there are problems, we solve them, and when there are kudos, we should celebrate together. Community involvement brings learning to life. Better than an apple or a thank you card, a community's support of the work we mutually do to teach and care for our future citizens is a great indication of how we value our teachers and the work they do. So remember, take a moment to share your appreciation not only individually with the teachers that have influenced your life, but stay informed and be active in your schools. Thank you. Superintendent's report.
Okay, the first piece of my report is an annual technology update by Gary Lanois.
I found this in my old file, one of my file cabinets. I've been doing this since 1994, so this is our first technology report, and by the looks of the computer on there, you can see that it's 1994 vintage. I've put together some things. It's kind of a hodgepodge of information, but it should bring you up to date on the technology initiatives and where we are in the district. First of all, Technology helps support the kinds of things that we do in the district. It supports and it's integral to the mission and the vision. My belief and the belief through, it's really been brought home through the laptop project. They keep talking about the laptop project is not about the technology, it's about teaching and learning and how technology can help and change teaching and learning. Some of the terms I like to use with technology is that it's invisible. That means that it has to work a high percentage of the time in order for teachers to be confident enough to use it in their classroom. So it just needs to be there and just be another tool. A term we heard in a laptop meeting just last week is technology is the accelerator for learning. In other words, I've heard from 7th and 8th grade staff that sometimes they can cover more content because they're using technology in the classroom. So those are just some generic terms. The rest of this is kind of updates. This year was the first year for mobile labs at the high school, and we ended up creating 7 carts of 24 laptops each, which is enough for any class, and they were assigned to departments. Departments managed the carts, and this seems to be working very well at the high school. They're pleased with that. Teachers are pleased. They're used a lot. We also have a few available in the library for students to check out while they're in the library and use throughout the building. I do want to thank CEEF, Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation. In the first year of the program, when we had one-to-one at the high school, we were able to get laptops for about half of our staff through the budget process. Thanks to CEEF, this past year, we were able to get laptops for the other half of the staff. So all the staff have laptops, the same kind of laptops that are in the carts, so that they can become familiar with the technology and use that technology with their classes. So mobile labs at the high school seem to be a big success. We were involved with the high school renovation, but it kind of behind-the-scenes type things. There was a lot. Through that project, basically the whole network was rebuilt at the high school. We ended up with a nice new network server room. When we first started doing technology in schools, they would find a room that was somewhere near where it needed to be, and they'd make a closet out of it. Doesn't matter what the room was. We had closets that were in the backs of classrooms that we had to kind of have a flashlight and climb up on things to see where things are and see where things are connected. Well, we have a room that's done right at the high school this year. All the network comes together in one central server room. That's where our servers are. That's where our internet connection is. It's even air-conditioned. And you might wonder, why do we need to air-condition it? Well, we have thousands and thousands of dollars worth of electronics equipment in that room, and the heat can shorten the life of that. So it is done right, and it's everything seems to be working well. And we were able to do this through the high school renovation project. The ATM room, the distance learning classroom, which is the old lecture hall, we originally incorporated that into the high school. My main reason for getting it was because it gave us a bigger data pipe to the internet, a bigger way to get out to the internet. It also has the capabilities of being a classroom where you can share and do courses between schools and different regions of the state. There are 70 plus high schools in the state connected to the distance learning network. We haven't used it as much. My excuse was last year that we were going through renovation and we just couldn't get things going on in there. The state is now finding that more and more schools and more places want these ATM sites. So if we don't use it for what the state determines it for, we may end up losing it. We can still find ourselves another way to get to the internet, but we may end up losing the distance learning piece of that. So that's something we need to take a look at. We're okay on the list next year, but we'll find out in the fall. The fall list comes out in the fall for the following year. And if that happens, then we'll have to figure out how we're going to do our internet connection. But we really want to see, is that something we want to keep? The technology staff and department have been involved in NWEA testing this year. And the reason we've been involved is because it's a computerized test. You take the test on the computers. And I tell you, one of the things that I was impressed, we've done MEA online tests and we've done NWEA tests. This works and works flawlessly. It is absolutely great. We set up the labs, we set up the computers, kids take tests on the computers, and I upload the data at the end of the day. The next day we have results. We have data for our students. So we'll be continually working with this, but I'm sure you've heard about it, but there's a big part of our staff and a big part of our work involved with that, and if more testing happens, and we do it multiple times in the year, then we'll be being involved more. Another thing that we need to be concerned about, budgets are tight. We all know that. Energy costs are going up. Computers use energy. So we've tried to put some things, some practices in place where we can try to conserve. Any little bit that we can say, we figure really will help. We've done things like have auto shutdowns on some of the computers. Some of the computers that are in classrooms, if people forget to turn them off, well, they'll turn themselves off because we've programmed it in there. We've talked to people about turning off monitors because the monitors use more power than the actual computers themselves. And we already had a practice where the labs and libraries were shut down by staff each day, but this just helps with that. So we're trying to do our part to help with the budget and to save energy. We've started putting in a few smart boards in the district. Now, a smart board is a brand name. The generic term is interactive whiteboard. Picture a whiteboard that's on the wall, and if you had a projector projecting towards that, and let's say I had an internet site on here, I can click a link on the whiteboard and it actually moves, or I can click the back button. So I can work the computer by just touching the board. The other thing it can do is it can capture screens and it can capture texts. to the computer so that you could share it digitally with your students. So we're going to get a couple of these in the middle school. We've got one in each building right now and looking for more. And we're going to get staff training on these this summer and see if this technology will help. Some budget stuff. EPS technology funding. There's targeted technology funds in the EPS funding formula, and this is kind of the chart that explains it. We get this form ED 281 from the state, and according to this, what the state has determined by doing surveys and things like that, that we should be allocating $85 a student for K-8 technology resources, $258 for 9 through 12. Now, the reason that it's lower for K through 8 is they're including the laptop, the new laptop program in that. So that's already being funded in that. That's my understanding. The reason it's higher at 9 through 12 is so that to try to encourage us to do one-to-one at the high schools. So if we look at what the state is saying we should be spending and what's in the 3.4% budget, we're below in both of those areas right now. Right now, as we understand it, we can't include staffing in that. So this is just technology expenses. We don't have the rules from the state yet. But it could be at some point in the future that if we don't spend this money, we may not get it from the state. That's, I think, where the state is heading. So I just wanted to point that out. We've kind of got away from our lab replacement schedule for a while. We used to replace a lab in a building each year. And if you, it's kind of hard to see, but this is the 2003-04 year. And you can see here are some labs that were replaced, middle school and so on. We look at our Pond Cove lab. It was purchased in 2001-02, so there's 1, 2, 3, 4. Those computers are 5 years old. If we get 5 or 6 years out of computers in a lab, we're probably doing pretty well. So we haven't, if you look at this, since 2003-04, we really haven't replaced any labs. So this year's budget reflects that. We're trying to start to get into some kind of a cycle again. And this sheet might look familiar because it's in your budget, and there's more beyond that kind of shows what the schedule is. But we do need to get back to some kind of a replacement schedule in the lab. So I just wanted to point that out. MILTI 2, the Maine Learning Technology Initiative, commonly called the laptop program. The state will be issuing new laptops to, we just attended a meeting last week, 7th and 8th grade students, both classes, would be getting new laptops. Teachers of 7th and 8th grade students, and they got formulas as far as which teachers would get it. They will be upgrading the network. Where it stands right now is the RFP that the state had was awarded to Apple Computer, and the contract's currently being negotiated, so they can't tell us details about hardware, when we're going to get it. Those kinds of things are still up in the air. We are going to get it, we just don't know when. So that's the status of that. Here's some interesting data. Just kind of pulled some numbers together today from my database. Some trouble calls, if you look at generally, 571. A trouble call is when we have to go and deal with a computer, some kind of issue. Some of these are quick things. Some of these are a day-long project. But 571 general trouble calls. The high school mobile lab has been relatively trouble-free. 23 calls there with the mobile labs.
Is this just in a year?
This is this year up to date. This is as of today. And at the middle school, we've had 603 trouble calls with, remember, we have 333 laptops there. And I broke that down a little bit. Generally, laptops have to be mailed in for repair, and we've mailed in 296 of them. Had to deal with 140 batteries and power adapters and those kinds of things. And we have had 15 broken screens. This broken screen number is, that's about average for what we've had over the past 3 or 4 years. So that's the kind of issues that we deal with on a yearly basis. What do we plan to do with the existing MILTI iBooks? Maybe you've been reading in the paper this $48 computer. Well, we are planning on buying those. All need to be reprocessed. We will be, even if we were sending them back to the state, we'd have to reimage them and get them back to a the original state. What we're planning to do is to sell off some of the older ones. The original laptop program started in two phases. 4 years ago, we got one set of laptops for one class, and then 3 years ago, we got another set. So they came in two waves. So these original, of these 333, some of them are 3 years old, some of them are 4 years old. The four-year-old ones, we're planning to sell off some of those and use the funds to help buy the newer ones and help to upgrade the newer ones. And we plan to keep the three-year-old ones. And this is kind of our plan of what we intend to do with those. Expand mobile carts for fifth and sixth grade. So the fifth grade would have a cart, 24 laptops, kind of like what the departments have at the high school, that they will deal with a small group. Sixth grade, an additional cart for Pond Cove. Back at that replacement lab schedule, I do have the very, very first mobile lab that we bought at the middle school is 5 to 6 years old now, so that one needs to be replaced. We're going to use some for NWEA testing. Right now, when we do NWEA testing, we have to reserve the labs in the libraries. We have to reserve blocks where we can get large quantities of computers so that we can test kids. If we have a set, say, two classrooms worth, then we can just need a classroom, set them up in there, and we can do the testing without interrupting the lab. And we will use some for repair parts. So that's our plan. Future work, our technology plan is coming up for renewal at the end of the next school year. So a big part of my work next year will be getting that reworked and rewritten. We'll be doing, and I'm sure, more NWEA. Of course, the whole new Milty project, that expansion, continued professional development, and then work with one-to-one. This next piece, people out there may not understand what one-to-one means in a classroom. This is not something that I wrote, but it's something I found on an email and a listserv. And we did this actually a couple of years ago, and I haven't shared it with school boards or people. We had it ready to go, and we're going to use it. And I think I'd just like to share it now. It's a quick little two-minute thing on what one-to-one means. So that's my report. Questions?
I have just a question?
Sure.
By purchasing all those extra laptops and ones that I'm guessing as they get older they have more problems, are we still looking, if the budget doesn't pass, at servicing all of those computer laptops with the existing staff that you have now?
Yes, because we're only going to keep half of them.
So it'd be, but it would be an additional 150 laptops needing support.
Correct. And they do, I mean, the warranty's off those, but I mean, that's why we've got a spare parts pool. We've got staff trained. One of my staff is now an Apple certified portable technician, so we can even repair our own screens on the laptops now. So we're going to bring some of the stuff in-house, and I'm hoping that we can, with our pool of spare parts, repair those fairly inexpensively and keep the three-year-olds running. Yes.
There was quite a gap between what the state said we should be spending and what we are spending. And at this point, you can't include salaries. What else? I mean, is that hardware and software that would, what exactly would we be spending money on to meet the state?
I'd have to look at my categories, but it is. There's hardware, there's software. I believe there's professional development. There's many categories involved in there. And when the rules are finally written and they finally come out, there may be pieces of salaries that could be included. And if we included some pieces of the salary, we'd meet those guidelines. If we didn't, then we wouldn't right now. Because of the direction on that sheet, that form that we got from the state said don't include staff salaries, we didn't right now.
And just this might be a question for Alan, actually, or both of you. When you were moving the carts to the fifth and sixth grade, or we'll have those available, which I think is great, I'm just curious to know whether the teachers at the high school might be able to share some how they use the carts, or is there time for professional development and training for the teachers to discuss how they'll actually use that so that it doesn't?
I've discussed it with both the fifth and sixth grade team leaders, and they're very, very anxious to get them. I don't think it'll take much staff development and training. They can't do some of the things now because the lab is in use when they want to bring a class down there, and this is going to kind of free up and bring the lab to them.
Right.
So I don't think it'll be a problem.
Thank you.
Larry?
Yes.
The standards that the state included, the 151, and it was a smaller number for the, was it 85,000?
85 and two, was it 250 or something?
All right. Well, that's what the state is telling us we should be spending on technology. Do you know how much the state is going to subsidize that by?
It'll be through our regular subsidy formula. So whatever our receiving rate is, we're going to, you know, get that same amount.
So the point I'm making, Alan, is that although they're requiring us to spend that amount of money, or they will take it back from us in a subsequent budget, we need to have the money to spend to begin with.
That's correct. Interestingly, I think you remember I told you last year they gave us a year's reprieve from spending it. Interestingly, I understand we have a second year's reprieve. So it'll be 07, 08 will be the first time that money will be taken away if we aren't doing it. But you're absolutely right. And one of the questions is, will there come a time when you can include at least part of your staff for that? Patricia?
So if they expect us to spend $150,000, but they don't reimburse us $150,000, they only reimburse us at our regular rate, how can they take away money that they haven't given us?
Well, that's my understanding. I'm sorry, I'll maybe.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Because every year they are giving us designated funds to technology. All right? They just plan on if we don't spend, you know, the recommended amount or the required amount, they will take that technology money that they gave us, for example, this year, and take it back from us next year. So if they gave us X amount, let's use $50,000, they're going to pay for a third of what's recommended for the high school. If we don't spend that $150,000, they're going to take part or all of that $50,000 back.
In other words, these are three targeted funds. Technology is one of those three. So we are expected to spend at the rate the state sets for us through the EPS formula.
Even if that's not what they're reimbursing
exactly.
us.
Exactly.
We never get reimbursed 100%.
Well, that's what I knew that, but it seems to me that they'll take back what they've given us.
Right.
But if we don't spend what they're telling us to spend, even though they haven't given us that amount.
That's right, which puts us even deeper into the hole.
In other words, because it's targeted, they consider those a part of our budget and therefore have to be spent that way.
But Alan, one would argue that we have spent the money that way because we are spending, let's say, $80,000, and of that, $50,000 is the targeted funds from the state.
And, you know, I look at you and hear you. I just know I have to deal with the state on it. And so that's, and therefore, we're not going to be penalized again this year. So,
but have they said that? Have they actually written it down that you need to spend the.
Yes. I can give you the documents right out of the budget. Okay. They're in the budget.
Okay.
Yep, for all three areas. The only other thing that I would add. I thank you when you did your trouble report that you didn't add the superintendent's office to it. Particularly tonight when my computer's dead again. Thank you very much.
And I really liked that video at the end, Gary. That was great. I hope a lot of people saw that.
We need copies for another governmental agency.
One thing I should add about his report, though, you remember we've had discussions through this entire budget process about relooking at every aspect of our budget. And you notice one of the things he talked about is the ATM. The ATM, to me, is something that we will spend some serious time early summer taking a look at, because I personally do not want to be losing the ATM if we can find ways to use it wisely, either at an adult level or student level. So it's those types of things, when Gary went over that with me on Friday, that I looked at it and said, this is another issue we've got to take a very serious look at before $94,000 goes. I can tell you there are 94 high schools in the state that have ATM because my last high school was the last one to get it. But they are beginning to shift out. And I would prefer it not shift unless we absolutely have to let it go.
Okay. Thank you.
Can we do the other two?
Yeah, superintendent's report. There are two more items.
Okay, the other two items on here are really quick items. The first one is just a mention to the board and the public that CEF will be meeting with the leadership team and with the board on May 16th. I've been talking with the leaders of CEF. We are now at the level of $750,000 raised. To endow this project, and it's really exciting. They will be meeting with us, and we'll do this on a yearly basis to take a look at the issues of the local grants, but also the big item grants that may come out of this process. And so I'm looking forward to that on the 16th. I think as a school system, we need to be very thankful that we have a group like this who is willing to put the effort in to make items possible for us that we can't do through school budget. I would also mention that we had a board workshop 2 weeks ago. The issue was updating information on bullying. At that workshop, the principals were there, also representatives from Pond Cove and the middle school, to talk about some of the issues around bullying and harassment. I thought the information that was shared was very helpful. We also have out there in the wings waiting to come in to work with us is Stan Davis, who is an internationally known expert on bullying. And we'll be continuing our look at that during the summer and as we look at our five-year plan and all of the pieces that we're putting together as we begin to change some of the focus here in Cape Elizabeth. So I did want to mention that we had had that workshop, and I think it was a very valuable workshop. And also to mention that we have another workshop in 2 weeks, and that workshop will be focused on the five-year plan. And taking a look at all the aspects of that. I would also like to close my report by doing like Elaine did and just saying a few words about teachers. As someone who considers himself a teacher, although it's been a long time since I actually was in the classroom, I'm ending my 37th year in education this year. And as we get to this point in May every year where it is time to recognize teachers, I always sit back and take a look at teachers and what they do for us, for our young people, and for the future. I certainly look at those teachers who are the talented, committed teachers, those people who are willing to give their time, their energy, and their soul to what they believe is right for young people. And I would say to you, without doubt, that you have an enormous number of teachers in this system who do that, and we should be very proud of that. We need to spend our time providing them both the support and the education necessary to keep moving us along. You heard from Gary about technology and how technology is constantly changing. We are looking at the process of teaching and learning and how it is changing also. But it is important that we remember that if we have trusted, enriching teachers, we need to recognize that they love what they do, they have the desire to do what they do, they're excited about it, and they see it as a challenge. And it is our job as educators to do everything we can to support those trusted, enriching teachers to make sure they're doing the very best for our system. And so from my perspective, I would say publicly, I want to thank the teachers in this system, the teachers who are in the classrooms, the teachers who are now administrators, the people who are working with those young people who will come through our schools, because it is so important. And with that, I need to go back to something Trish said tonight. I went over and visited Pond Cove the day after you had done the work over there. And I need to tell you that from the perspective of Pond Cove teachers, when they walked down the halls that day and stopped to make sure I saw every one of those bathrooms, that tribute that the parents paid to those teachers is unbelievable. They are bathrooms that have been decorated in the finest way. And that is the type of thing that as teachers, as people who work in education, that is the type of pat on the back that is badly needed. And I hope that the people who have done it, including you, understand how highly regarded that work is and how highly regarded we need to spend our time looking at our teachers, because we have so many who are trusted and enriching, and make sure that we do everything we can to enrich the work they do to enhance student learning. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. Trish, would you like to make a comment?
Would you mind?
Not at all.
I was just thinking when you were saying that, I think there are some teachers that we should thank also, the art and music department teachers, for inspiring this talented students we have. Last week we all enjoyed Arts Week with the various art displays and the music concerts at the high school, and I think those teachers need to be commended. The performances were great, so we have talented students, but certainly the talents were drawn out by our talented and dedicated teachers, so a thank you to those teachers as well. Thank you.
Why don't we move on to item number 10, our committee reports. We'll start with the Finance Committee. Rebecca?
We met on April 25th and signed warrants, reviewed the monthly energy report, and pretty much at status quo. We reviewed the food service report, and things look like they're in pretty good shape. We did discuss with Pauline working to get break-even prices of the lunches for the fall, so we can analyze whether we're charging enough to break even. And then following that, we discussed a little follow-up discussion regarding the budget, the 0607 budget, and some new enrollment figures that we had come up with and how we wanted to present that to the town council. And our next meeting is Tuesday, May 30th at 12:30. And we're going to be joined by Connie that day. That's Connie Goldman.
Thank you. Planning Committee, Trish?
We met on April 24th. We discussed the length of the planning cycle, whether it made sense at 5 years, and how to make it more manageable and measurable. Alan and Sarah Simmons will be attending staff meetings to discuss the future direction plan and efforts to refocus on that, Alan reported. We supported Alan's request to host a year-end staff luncheon on the last day of school, and we also talked about the agenda for the upcoming May 24th school board workshop on the long-range plan and sort of drafted a tentative agenda for that. Our next meeting is this Thursday, the whatever day that is, 11th at 9:45.
Thank you. Policy Committee, Ann.
The Policy Committee met on April 11th, and mostly we discussed the policies that we'll be presenting later this evening for first reading, and those would be student travel and field trips, which we've been working on for quite a while. Board negotiating agents, which has to do with negotiating teacher and administrative contracts. And I guess the third one that we discussed in much detail is employer computer and internet use rules. So we'll be presenting those later.
Thank you. Substance Abuse Policy Review Subcommittee. Trish?
We have not met since the last meeting. We did present the policy to the policy committee at their last meeting, and that will be presented for first reading. But I would like to, at this point, because it is at the point where the policy draft is at first reading, I'd like to thank by name the committee members who served on that committee, because they spent a year and a lot of time and effort working on this. So a thank you to them. And those people are Ann Belden, Officer Mark Gravel, high school students Mary Cox, Heather Furman, and Daly Gruen, Katie Lisa, Rick Madden, Elaine Maloney, Steve Price, Jeff Shedd, Mark Tinkham, and Keith Weatherby. So a thank you to all those people for their dedication on that project.
Thank you. Wellness Committee, Ann?
The Wellness Committee met on April 13th, and we're moving ahead on the work that will lead us towards developing the new policy that's been mandated that we need to have in place by fall, this coming fall of 06. And what we discussed at our last meeting, which I think I mentioned last month, is the survey that we decided to do to the schools. So Dean Zaharis came to our meeting to help us understand what the capabilities would be in terms of a survey that we would do electronically. And so we will be, and hopefully we're still on our time frame with this, the survey will be complete and ready to be distributed next week, the second week of May, if we're still on target with that. And so this is a survey that's going to go out to parents, staff, and students, and it will be looking at the whole range of wellness issues that we've been mandated to address through this wellness policy. That includes physical activity, nutrition in our schools, evaluation of activity, and I don't know, several other areas which I can't think of at this moment. But the surveys are quite lengthy. They are going to be able to be done online. And it's going to really give us the feedback that we would like to have very much before we then do the next step in terms of drafting our policy. Maine School Management Association has done a draft of a sample draft for schools to sort of use as a jumping off point. And they have just gotten that out to us, and we are going to be looking at that at our next meeting. But we feel that the information that we'll get from our own community in terms of perceptions and real practices will be really helpful when we get down to that point of drafting the policy. So I know that there's going to be information that will go out in the Courier about it, and I know that our administrators are going to be encouraging their staff and students to all fill it out, and we would like to encourage parents in the community to take a little bit of time and get that information to us. It would be very helpful. I think that's it. Our next meeting is in May 18th.
Thank you, Ann. Kathy, Personnel Committee?
Personnel Committee didn't meet since the last school board meeting.
But we have a few things to discuss this evening.
Right. Did you want that now or
no, I think
later?
I think we get it on the agenda later.
Okay, that's so what I thought.
We've been working hard, so it'll come up for discussion.
Okay.
Communications Committee, Rebecca.
Trish, do you want to do this since you wrote the minutes, or would you like me to?
You can.
Oh, thank you so much. Okay, well, we met, and I don't remember the day, I apologize, but we discussed several items. The first was starting a discussion around making a recommendation on advocacy policies, guidelines for the district. And then the second item was to start to brainstorm and formulate a standard fact sheet, budget fact sheet, that can be presented to the public every year, and hopefully avoid having to reinvent the wheel year after year. It would just be a standardized form. Information would be dropped into it and can be made public through the various avenues that we have available. So we are meeting again June 1st at 3:05 in the Pond Cove Media Center to follow up on those discussions.
Great. Kevin, Student Extracurricular Committee?
Yes. We will be meeting tomorrow at 2:30, actually, not 2 o'clock, in the Jordan Conference Room. And the topics for tomorrow include the review of current athletic policies, as well as any requests for new policy that might be coming down the pike regarding athletics in particular. That's quite a bit to do tomorrow. We have received requests, one from girls ice hockey, asking that we arrange for to hear their requests for club sports status. And we've also heard from the Kids Turf Committee, who are looking for guidance in terms of how we can assist with gate receipts and policies on gate receipts. And I think that takes a lot more than just a simple conversation, because there is some things that we will need to do in conjunction with the town council. I do plan, we haven't scheduled a date yet, but hopefully we'll be able to fit in another meeting in June so we can actually turn over policy notes and recommendations to Ann and the rest of the policy committee.
Great. Reports from non-board committees. Rebecca, legislative.
Okay, well, I believe you're all aware of the recent Supreme Court ruling, so we will be dealing with Tabor this year. And you'll find nicely included by Alan some information in your packets regarding Tabor. We had taken it off the agenda for a school board position vote. I think I'd like to ask that that be placed back on for the June meeting. And I think that means that I should probably come up with a draft statement.
You know, I'm guessing the MSMA is going to...
They said they were working on it. I just don't know if they've come out with one yet. But I'll look into that.
It hasn't come out as of today, but that doesn't mean...
I'm sure that they're working on it much more quickly now. And lastly... as I mentioned earlier, Connie Goldman will be attending the Finance Committee meeting, and I suspect will be offered a great insight into what's been going on in Augusta this past year and in the future months ahead.
Great. Kevin, some information on PASS?
Yes. I finally made it back to PASS. It's first time since January. A lot of exciting things going on. Back in January, we began our five-year plan, which includes a complete review of curriculum, scheduling issues, and other concerns of the sending schools. In terms of curriculum, what we're looking at is an examination of current courses and whether or not they continue to be relevant in the 21st century. We already have some progress in that area. The Marine Engineering Engine Repair Program has been fully funded for 2 years through Perkins Grant, so there is no cost to us. The course is fully enrolled. Mercury Marine, who is one of the major manufacturers of boat engines, has come on board as a sponsor as well, providing the school with all sorts of equipment and things. So we're very excited that that program is off for to such a good start. We had a visitor at our last meeting, which was last week, who is extremely interested in instituting a communications technology program, which is more in tune with meeting 21st century needs. The staff at PASS will begin working on that almost immediately. Hopefully, we'll be able to present that as a new program next year. Another note is there is the word arts in the title of the high school, and one of the things that we seriously would like to do is expand the arts programming, beginning with adding to music and dance a theater program. The ultimate goal is to perhaps develop a freestanding arts academy as somewhat of a magnet school for the area. Another area that we are looking at in terms of 21st century careers is the burgeoning need for health-related workers, whether they're aides or full-scale nurses and beyond. We are hoping with all of these things to make a connection or reconnect with the community college, the local community colleges, in order to provide multi-year programming that will hopefully result in an AA or an AS degree for students involved in some of these courses. I'll be working on that myself quite a bit in conjunction with the administration. Finally, the machine tool program has been updated, and we have added computer-assisted manufacturing to that program, specifically by means of robotics. So a lot of exciting things going on at PASS. Graduation is on 5/19/06. Claire, I need your help on this. Are we the AM or PM session? You know? We're doing both sessions now. Well, that'll be some interesting logistics. I will get more information from PASS and Claire and distribute that to anybody who's interested. That's it for PASS. That was our last meeting for the year. There'll be committee meetings going on throughout the summer.
Great. Board advisory committees. I'm just going to report on the town's comprehensive plan committee and note that on June 15th, which is Thursday evening, there will be a public forum here in council chambers where the comprehensive committee will be looking for public input on some of the chapters that they've recently completed and is in draft form and can be read online. And some of those topics were recreation, housing. One of the topics that kind of relates to the school systems themselves is an analysis of the population in Cape Elizabeth. And there is really no discussion in there in regards to school population. We are going to be addressing that under the work that Alan and myself will be doing and presenting to the committee later on in the year. Speaking of which, the school will be presenting to the Comprehensive Committee under Public Facilities, which again is an analysis of our facility needs, and also under Fiscal Capacity, which are two very important topics that I think that the Comprehensive Planning Committee is certainly taking a look at as we struggle with how to fund education in our community with such a limited tax base. So I think that forum will most likely be in November, but I encourage both school board members and the community to get involved in the June 15th forum and to follow the process throughout the year.
Elaine, excuse me, if you can't attend that meeting, is there the option, if it's online, to send questions and through email? Can people do that as well?
Yes, on the website, you may send, we actually receive email letters and written letters from community members who've had concerns about some of the, you know, recommendations that we've started talking about. So if you do have some input and you can't attend on the 15th, I would encourage you to send it to the full committee or through Maureen O'Meara, which is the planner. Unfinished business. Consideration of policies for the second reading. Ann.
Okay, we have five policies tonight for second reading. The first three are in the E section, and they have to all do with transportation issues. There are no changes on any of these three from last month, and there have been no other discussions from the policy committee on these. So can we just take these three together? Is that okay?
I think that's fine.
Then I'd like to make a motion that the board approve policy EE, Transportation Services and Management, as presented here, policy EEAE, School Bus Safety, and actually the other one is a guideline, so it doesn't need to be voted on.
Okay.
So.
Is there a second? Thank you, Kevin. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? 7-0.
And then the other two are J policies. First is one policy and one guideline, JICC, student conduct on buses, and the second is the guidelines that goes along with that. So I'd like to make a motion that the board accept JICC as presented here.
Is there a second? Thank you, Trish. Comments, questions? All those in favor? 7-0. So that does it.
Oh, that's it.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. Consideration of motion for vote on the 2006-07 budget. Alan, would you like to explain this?
What you have in front of you is a one-page document that says motion for vote on the 2006-07 budget. What we have to do each year is have language ready for the town council for the final work they're doing. What you have in front of you is the language that talks about the school budget amount, the amount that is for additional funding, and the amount that is above and beyond the EPS. The amounts that you see in there are a 6.95 budget, because that is what you voted for in the beginning. Well, all we have to do tonight is I have to just get this language approved so that it is ready. Once the budget is actually set next Monday, then there may be some adjustments that need to be made. But the language we have to have done by Friday in order to move things ahead. So what I'm seeking is a motion to accept the language and with revisions once budget is set.
Okay. Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's consideration of the 2006-07 budget?
So moved.
Thank you, Ann. Do I have a second? Kevin? Any questions?
If these numbers need to be adjusted, does that require another vote by the school board?
What will happen is, based on what the town council decides to make the final budget, we won't have to come back to the school board to make the changes unless there are questions that you want to address. But otherwise, it'll be based on what that budget number is.
Okay. All those in favor? Be 7-0. We have new business, and I'm going to shift number D up to the number A, or letter A, and that is consideration of the superintendent's nomination for director of special services.
Thank you very much. Dominic has been sitting here through most of the meeting. I know he has young children at home and he's been in Kittery all day long. So I wanted to move this up to the new business so Dominic could also get a chance to leave and at least say hello to his kids before they're sound asleep. Candidate that I'd like to nominate tonight is Dominic DePazzi for Director of Special Services here in the Cape Elizabeth School System. I would say to you, this is my first round of hiring since I've been here. Started with a top administrative position. And I say top administrative position because I mean that very seriously. The special ed director is an extremely important part of the work that we do here. I can't thank Claire enough for all the work she has done over a period of years and the work I've done with her this year. But I also know that we have a change that is to happen. We put it out. We had several applicants. We had originally interviewed four applicants. We did a second round of two applicants. We had 13 people on the team, which included a broad range of people, including two members of the board. The second round in particular, we really got deeply into questions about the operation of the system and the operation of special education. Dominic certainly came through as the star. He did a tremendous job for us. My job, obviously, after that was done, is to check references, and I had a wonderful 2 days doing reference checks all across the state. I had known Dominic briefly when he was at Lincoln Academy. I knew that he was in Kittery, had heard a lot of good reports. Dominic was in Mexico when we made the decision, so I talked with Dominic in Mexico to get a commitment from him for this position. So it gives me a great deal of pleasure to nominate Dominic DePazzi as the new Special Services Director to begin July 1st of 2006. I would mention also that his superintendent, a former classmate of mine in college, who I wasn't sure would offer anything, but agreed to let Dominic join us on the 21st, 22nd, and 23rd of June as the administrative team is meeting as we do planning for next year. So I would ask you to nominate Dominic as the new Director of Special Services.
Thank you, Alan, for the introduction. Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation to retain Dominic DePazzi as our new Director of Special Services. I had the opportunity to participate in that process, and Dominic, you have my enthusiastic endorsement for what that's worth.
Thank you. Do I have a second? Kathy? Any questions? All those in favor? 7-0. Welcome. Thank you.
I don't know. I always hate to put people on the spot, but would you like to say a word or two, or would you like to be quiet?
I'm just really glad, and I can't wait to start, and got ideas going, and got to finish up down here, but I'm very excited to come up. So I'm looking forward to your administrative meeting and meeting all the administrators. Ready to come up.
Great.
Thank you, Dominic. And you can feel free to go home.
Okay, we'll move back to the original order, and we have under the original A is consideration of job descriptions from the Personnel Committee. We received in our packet, I didn't count them all, Kathy, but the result of a lot of work on the part of Kathy and the Personnel Committee to update and the administrators who assisted with the writing of these job descriptions or updating. So if you want to just take it from here, Kathy, and answer questions.
Okay. Mary and Pauline sent out a packet to the school board because I wanted to get them out as early as possible so people could review them and so forth. And we got back some good questions and made a couple of changes. And there was an additional email, and Alan, you might have to help me. We're pulling out the three EdTech
ones. Yes. We need to review those again with some specific questions that have come up.
Okay, so I apologize for those coming out of the packet tonight, but they'll be right back, along with a few more. So with that said, Mary again put them into our school board packet, so if anybody was like me and said, oh, I don't know what I did with them all, but I'm hoping that folks got a chance to read them, and you know, if there's any additional questions and so forth, I don't know, maybe how we want to do this, to take them as a group or take them individually, but if it's as a group, if that's all right, what I'd like to do is propose that we, I guess, make a motion that we accept the job descriptions that we've been given, with the exception of the EdTech, three EdTech jobs. And I don't know, Alan, maybe you can give me some ideas, but I'm thinking that once they're accepted that we'll get them into a regular book, so right, that if anybody wants them, they can, you know, get the original copy. I mean, you know, get a copy. And as time goes on, as we change or make any additions, we'll, you know, put them in and out of the book.
My intent would also be doing like we are with policy and have a section on our website that has our job descriptions.
Well, I had actually asked Dan about that with reference to the policies, and once they're completed, I'd want to get them on the website so anybody can pull them off. And there are a bunch more coming, so I'd like to say this was it, but we still have quite a few others. And we, you know, there really was a lot of work that went into this. The Personnel Committee worked hard on them. The different departments worked hard on them. They'd come back and forth. They'd go back to the department. They'd come back to us, go back to Pauline. You know, Mary, it was just back and forth and back and forth. And we tried to make sure that we covered, you know, all possible subject matter, and also that they were uniform between each other, so that one, because we had a whole bunch of different formats that kept coming through, and so Pauline was very helpful in getting those formats back to, you know, one particular format, so that when you looked at this job description, it was the same in terms of the format for all the other ones. So I'm probably talking way too much, but anyway. I guess I'd like to make a motion that we accept the job descriptions as put forward by the Personnel Committee.
Is there a second? Linda? Any further questions for Kathy? Rebecca?
Kathy, were the changes on the high school, middle school made yet?
They're not in this packet, no, because you brought them up, I think, yesterday, maybe.
Okay.
So they're not here, because you had the packet already. But I've talked with Pauline, and we're going to make that change.
Okay.
Because that was a very good point. I think I copied everyone on that particular email.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. All those in favor? 7-0. Consideration of the nominations of the superintendent of teachers for continuing contract.
Okay, you have two sheets in your packet. The first one says teachers eligible for continuing contract status. In other words, these are second year probationary teachers who've been through their 2 years of evaluation. I just wanted to make clear once again, I have very strong feelings about probationary teachers. We bring in some wonderful people. But it is extremely important from an administrative point of view that we do very careful observation over that two-year period to make determinations on whether they move from the probationary status to the continuing contract status. Because continuing contract status does change the level of the playing field as far as evaluation is concerned. The people that you have on this list are people that started last year. I obviously did not get to know them last year, but I have talked frequently with the administrators who are evaluating them to make sure that the quote I always use is, once you hire them in continuing contract, you have made it at least a $1 million commitment as long as they stay here for a period of time. So let's make sure they're the very best. What you have here tonight are three teachers from Pond Cove, two from the middle school, seven from the high school, and two system-wide people. These people have been evaluated carefully over a two-year period. Again, I've met with their evaluators. I've read the evaluations. I've talked with the evaluators, and they feel strongly that these people are ready to become continuing contract teachers in Cape Elizabeth. I don't know if you want me to read the names or if you want to go by the list or go by the school. I'm happy to go whatever route you would like to do this.
I would just like to propose that you read the names and then we would vote on them as a group. If anyone would like to suggest something differently, then why don't we do that?
Okay, fine. First one is Pond Cove School. We have four candidates. Talia Edlund, who is for grade 2. Sarah Hollowell, grade 1. Cindy Perkins, social worker. And Lynn Spadinger, who is grade 2. At the middle school, you have Amy Matthews, who is world language, and Melissa Sullivan, who is halftime at grade 8. At the high school, you have Mark Ash, who is social studies, Matt Clements, who is math, Sean Garrett, who is science, Susan Garrett, who is science, Chris Haywood, who is English, Brandy LaPointe, who is guidance, and Evan Thayer, who is math. On a system-wide approach, you have Deborah Hannon, who is a social worker, And you have Mary Jane Call, who I mentioned earlier tonight, if you remember, who is a three-day-a-week psychologist for us.
Thank you. Do I have motion to consider these nominations of the superintendent? Thank you, Kevin. Second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further questions? All those in favor? 7-0. Next, we have consideration of the nomination of the superintendent of teachers for second-year probationary contracts.
And that is the second sheet that you have. Again, I have five teachers at Pond Cove, three at the middle school, and four at the high school. Those people are at Pond Cove, Nicole Ball, who's a half-time kindergarten teacher, Morgan Burns, who is special ed, Lisa Derman, grade 2, Mary Ann Harrington, grade 2, Tara Piasecki, who is a grade 2. Remember, you have been changing grade 2 teachers over a period of time because of retirements. Middle school is Margaret Lala Rohner, who is art, Susan Quirk, grade 6, and Holly Smevog, who will be returning as a computer integrator. The high school is Allison Wyther, who is Spanish, Lisa Melanson, who is the English and Achievement Center, Robert Thompson, who is SPED and also at the Achievement Center, and Ginger Raspiller, who is running the Achievement Center for us at this point. Remember that, for instance, Ginger is a good example. Ginger was here in the technology department. When she became a teacher, she came back to a two-year cycle of evaluation.
Do I have a motion? Thank you, Kevin. A second. Kathy, any further comments or questions regarding the nominations? Being none, all those in favor? 7-0. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendation to co-curricular fee positions.
Pardon me?
No.
First year.
Let's back up to E. Consideration of the superintendent's nominations of teachers for their first-year probationary contracts.
I have two nominations before you, both middle school. The first one is Adam Killip, who is being nominated as a grade 5 science and math teacher. Again, I've had pretty in-depth conversations with Steve Conley about both of these candidates and the amount of work they did in order to seek out these candidates. They had a well-filled pool of candidates, and so, which is always nice because you get a chance to look at the broad run of candidates. I've met with Adam. Adam is coming to us from Mount Ararat. Adam has a degree from the university in May of 2002. He is a candidate for a master's degree. Will finish up in 2008. Have had, again, through Steve, some very, very high recommendations for him. And so I would ask you to nominate and place Adam Killip as a first-year probationary teacher.
Can I have a motion for that recommendation?
So moved.
Thank you, Ann. Second? Linda, any questions? Comments? Being none, all those in favor? Be 7-0.
The second candidate you have before you is Douglas Maker. Douglas has been nominated for 7th and 8th grade science position at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. If you look at Douglas's background, he lives in Naples and for 14 years taught at Lake Region Middle School. From that point, he moved to Greeley, where he had a one-year position there that was lost as cuts were made in the positions. He then moved to Harrison, and it has been in Scarborough for the last 2 years. Doug was a candidate that both Steve and I had heard about and heard about the wonderful work he's been doing. And so we were quite pleased that he applied for the position and went through the interview and did a tremendous job. I have met with Doug. Doug had some early experience here in Cape Elizabeth, and Mary knew him back then. But I would ask you to do the same, to nominate and appoint Doug Maker as a 7th and 8th grade science teacher, first-year contract.
Thank you. Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation?
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. Second? Thank you, Rebecca. Any questions? All those in favor? We have 7-0. Now we'll move to the superintendent's recommendation to co-curricular fee positions.
I have one nomination here. This is from Claire LaBrie. This is for the Special Olympics co-curricular activity, and what she has done is divide that activity up into 50 and 25 percentages, with Karen Johnson doing 50% at $734, Kristen Cobb and Morgan Burns doing 25% each at $367, which that total adds up to the amount available for a Special Olympics program.
Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation?
So moved.
Kevin, thank you. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Ann. Any questions regarding this recommendation? All those in favor? It's 7-0. Consideration of adoption of proposed school calendar for the 2006-07 school year.
I think the only change that you find on it, Mary, if I'm correct, is if you look in August, where you see the 28th, 29th, and 30th in yellow, there was a question the last time about the 30th and what that means. And so what we've tried to define here, that August 30th is the first day for students and the ninth grade only at the high school. And then the 31st and the 1st are days for the other students. Did I do that right?
Yes. 31st
and the 1st. Yes, I'm sorry, I read the wrong dates there. But that asterisk was the one you questioned before and what that truly meant. I don't think there are any other changes, Mary. We didn't do any others.
Great, thank you. It's amazing how you could find space to fit that on there.
Believe me, we talked a lot about it.
All right, do I have a motion to accept the proposed school calendar for the year 2006-07?
So moved.
Thank you, Rebecca. A second? Thank you, Linda. Any further questions? Being none, all those in favor? 7-0. We now move on to policies for the first reading.
Okay, the first one is employee computer and internet use rules. And this particular set of guidelines was actually just adopted in January of 06 because of a situation that recently we just experienced. We decided that we needed to take another look at this. And as you can see on the second page, there are just two changes in red that the policy committee is putting forward to as a change to this policy.
Could you just clarify that for the public, what those changes are?
Sure. Well, item number 4 under prohibited uses currently reads any use for commercial advertising or solicitation purposes, and what we're adding is the word political. So it would now read any use for commercial, political, advertising, or solicitation purposes. And number 5, without reading that whole kind of lengthy paragraph, what this paragraph refers to is the use of mass email and who might be allowed to use the school email system. And it currently says that no employee, this is just pulling out a part of it where the change is, no employee shall knowingly provide school email addresses to outside parties. And we're suggesting that the phrase including parent associations would be added there to go along with outside parties. So those are the two changes to this policy.
Great. Can I ask a quick question? Is this a guideline? Because it has an R on it?
Yeah.
So it's a guideline. Okay.
Yeah. So but we do the first and second readings on guidelines.
Okay. Even though they're not. Wasn't sure. Thanks.
Okay. Any other comments?
I guess I'm curious to know, when you include parent associations as outside parties, how, from a practicality standpoint, that would be enforced, since the parent associations produce the directory, which provides all the staff emails? How would one know whether the parent got the email from a staff member or from the directory?
Yep, that's a good point.
I guess technically, well, the parent associations aren't separate legal entities anyway, but from a practical enforceability standpoint, I'm just curious to know how you would know that, how you would enforce the policy.
Yeah, and I think one of the tough issues with this whole policy that we talked a lot about, that I think the water is still somewhat muddy around, is how any emails, you know, get places. I mean, emails jump around, email addresses jump around so easily, and information is shared in so many different ways by so many different people. And I think you raise certainly a good point.
This may help. It says, no employee, et cetera, for non-school purposes, whereas one would assume that parents would communicate with staff for school purposes. Your concern is about the directories that are produced, and they have staff emails in those directories?
Well, I'm just concerned about it. I mean, from a practical standpoint, we've tried very hard to develop policies that we can, that mean something, that we can stand by and that we can enforce. And I guess I have a question, how you would, parents associations produce the directories that include staff emails. So if I, as a parent, for example, send out a mass email to the staff, how will you be able to hold this up to a staff and say, you violated this policy?
I can't.
If I, as a member of the association, could extract those.
A parent can send a mass email to staff by using the website if they so chose to. So I think we need to, the directories is a non-issue.
So then why do we need this in here?
Yeah, that's a good point.
To me, anyway, I wasn't there for this meeting, but the way I'm interpreting it is basically where Rebecca went a few minutes ago, is that what it does, it just puts language in there for this. And so what it does is, from a perspective of how we manage the process, if we run into a problem where an email is sent out that has non-school information on it, we at least have something in the language that would allow us to question it. Right now we have nothing that was clearly able to do that. I understand what you're asking, is that we do have these directories that come out with all of the emails, but it says no employee shall knowingly provide. I think the word knowingly is an important word there. Whose intent is to communicate with school employees, students, and our families for non-school purposes. I think that's what we're trying to get at and make sure it does not happen. Employees who are uncertain as to whether particular activities are acceptable should seek further guidance from the building principal or other appropriate administrator. My view of it, anyway, is that that's just there as another piece to the puzzle. That, you know, as a parents' organization, if you're using the emails through the school system, that you're using it for school business and not non-school business, or not political information that is not allowed in the way we do it. Now, that's the way I'm looking at it, and it just puts that language in there. I don't know, who brought the recommendation to that, but I know it's been my concern right along that we just don't have that language there to protect.
I think we have two separate issues here. I think what this was trying to get at was parent email addresses being accessed by non-school people. So maybe the wording of this needs to be clarified a little bit. And then the other issue was, I believe, the communication to teachers by teachers, which takes care of any use of commercial political advertising purposes. So perhaps we just need to clarify when it says school email addresses, we need to say parent email addresses instead.
With the language that's in there, it seems to me that the gate is open. Who gets to decide what is school business and who, what isn't? Arguably, information about the budget is school business. All right? Other people may take a different position. And I kind of agree with Rebecca that the issue was around the misunderstanding of whose email list was being used. The individual who was sending out emails was operating with their own list, okay, and not the school list. We did have another situation where the school list was used, but that was done by an employee, and that's adequately covered. But, you know, the question about, you know, I would tend to tread warily, because email addresses are, you know, in theory, public domain. You know, people made that point in the meeting that, heck, I get all kinds of mail from everywhere, from people I have no clue who they are. I didn't ask to be on their list. You know, some of it's political, some of it's just other stuff. So, you know, I certainly don't want the school to be liable for the misuse of our list, but I think we all have to recognize that our list is out there regardless.
So it sort of sounds like, I mean, we have a couple people who are on the policy committee who are, you know, wondering about the recommendation, and so it sounds to me like it's there were definitely some feelings about putting this in there, but I'm hearing now that there are at least two people on the policy committee who are struggling with it. And so I guess I'd like to suggest that we take it back and look at it again at the next policy committee meeting.
Is there any type of guidance from MSMA or from Drummond and Woodsum in regards to email?
Well, I think this originally, I mean, this was actually a whole new set of policies, Gary, right, when we looked at this in December and January. And so this was part of that whole packet of technology guideline recommendations and all that stuff. So pretty much we took what we, I'm sure there were probably some changes, I don't remember, you know, 5 months ago, but basically we took their recommendations. Now, what we did is we reacted to a specific situation that people had very strong feelings about, and, you know, one way or the other. And that's why we pulled this policy back out, and some folks felt that a few things needed to be added to clarify. But I would like to take it back and have us take another look at it.
And I want to apologize if I really don't even remember this wording, so I clearly was not being...
Well, that's right. Actually, there are three people on the policy committee, so I think we really need to take this back and have another look.
Okay. And look at it as a full paragraph.
Well,
number five is a full paragraph and how it works.
Well, yeah, I mean, we did do that, but I think feelings are now apparently changing because I'm not hearing from anybody who was on the committee, who was taking part in the discussion, that they're wanting this in there, and I certainly wasn't, you know, in favor of adding this. So I think we need another conversation. Okay, the next policy is HF, Board Negotiating Agents. And this was a policy that we asked the Personnel Committee to take a look at. They did, and then they brought it back to the Policy Committee. And so you can see the changes in red are the ones that the Policy Committee came up with, and the ones that are correct me if I'm wrong. The ones that are crossed out, Mary, those are the ones that Drummond Woodsum recommended. Yep. Okay.
I think those look good. Does anyone have any questions, concerns on those?
Then the next one is IHOA student travel and field trips. And This is essentially a whole new policy. We do currently have an IHOA, which is under a different title, field trips non-athletic. But as we delved into this, more and more and more questions came up, and Jeff Shedd sort of took it upon himself at our request to help us in reviewing, graciously took it upon himself, and reviewed a number of different policies, literally in different states. And so we have clearly, I mean, now we have like an 8-page policy, whereas before we had half a page. But I think it addresses just a lot of different issues that we really needed to take a look at. The original policy is 10 years old when it was revised. So anyway, there are a lot of different categories in here.
This was great work, and I think it'll help the board in the future figure out what it is that we're actually approving and the guidelines are. Does anyone have any comments for Ann?
Can I back up 1 minute on the board negotiating agent?
Oh.
I might be completely wrong. I was reading this, and I think our recommendation, and maybe Kevin remembers, I think our recommendation said the chair of the personnel committee in consultation with the superintendent.
That's correct.
But I thought we talked about that and keeping it in line with all of our other procedures for the process.
Right, and I think that's why we did it that way, but I don't have my book with me, so I don't have my notes. Do you remember?
I believe it was the chair of the personnel committee. It was a recommendation from the personnel committee to the policy committee.
I do remember a conversation at the policy committee, however, about this recommendation. I do not remember how it was concluded, but I would assume that if it was written this way, that would have been what the conclusion of the policy committee was.
Yeah, what it was that we talked a lot about the process through which other, you know, groups or teams or subcommittees are designated, and we wanted it to be a parallel process. And I think that the first one was chair of the personnel committee, but we changed it to the board.
Did we do that? I don't remember.
I remember.
My recollection is there was something in there about being affirmed by the board, as we do with other things. But perhaps I'm misunderstanding the nature of the relationship, but isn't the negotiation committee part of the personnel committee?
Right.
I mean, that's what was originally intended, was the merger of those two committees.
Okay, so why don't we take that back, since none of us are really clear in our memories, because it's late. So,
I'm sorry.
Why don't we just take this back, Kathy, and we can...
Maybe we can just try to remember.
I mean, this is the first reading, so...
It goes back anyway.
Yeah.
And also, just out of curiosity, this is in Section HF. Is this part of board governance, that it would be in Section B? If you're trying to adhere to the same procedures?
I don't know. This is where, I guess it's, I mean, it's already
too.
Put.
So if, for consistency, if it's board governance, that may guide us.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, so then getting back to the student travel, were there other comments on that? Questions, comments?
Other than I think that's great to finally have it in writing.
Okay.
Jeff, thank you.
Okay, and then the last one is the substance abuse, and I'm going to turn this over to Trish as the chair of that subcommittee.
The policy was presented, or this draft was presented to the policy committee, and there were some concerns about the meetings, the sufficiency on page 9. Page 5. There is a discussion that there will be mandatory meetings for students and parents. And the way it reads now, it says that early in the school year, there'll be two meetings held. There was some concern that perhaps one of the meetings should be held during, or a mid-year during the school to allow an opportunity for students who decide mid-year to participate. So the language in this section needs to change. I don't know if we want to discuss that at the policy committee, if you want me to make a proposal now. I'm not sure what the right protocol is.
Do you want to tell us?
The subcommittee agreed that perhaps, at least for the first year, and that we would review it similar to what we've done with some other policies, that the language could read that there'll be two meetings held during the school year, at least one of them prior to the occurrence of the first countable interscholastic competition of any sort. So that leaves the door open for having a meeting in response to that concern from the policy committee.
Trish, the issue of preseason.
I think that language, we are aware of that. I think, Jeff, you can help me out maybe. I know we were talking to Keith. I don't think that language precludes that. So the policy language would allow for that. From a logistical standpoint, I believe that is being addressed.
Okay. Any other comments for this policy? Okay.
So we'll come up with a clean draft with that.
Yeah.
And then that would be presented in our June meeting for second reading. Okay. Great. Thank you for all the work on that.
And I think that's it for the policies.
Thank you. Item I. Consideration of the proposed negotiated agreement with the Cape Elizabeth Educational Administrators Association. Alan,
yes.
Is there anything? We all have it in our packets. Right. Is there anything that we want to bring up regarding this contract?
I think basically, if there are any specific questions you have, we try to get it to all of you beforehand so you get a chance to read it and check on any questions. So I'd be happy to answer anything that I can on the contract. And if there are no questions, then to move ahead for adoption.
Okay. Could I have a motion to accept the bargaining agreement between the Cape Elizabeth School Board and the Cape Elizabeth Educational Administrators Association for July 1st, 2006 to June 30th, 2009?
So moved.
Thank you, Kevin. It'd be a second. Trish, any further questions or comments? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Consideration of resignations, item J.
I have three resignations this evening. I know you have two. I'm not sure if you have the third one because it just came across my desk today, but I decided to bring it anyway. First one is from Mark Tinkham, who is assistant principal at Cape Elizabeth High School. This is his letter in which he is acknowledging with mixed emotions that he is submitting his letter of resignation effective at the end of the 2005-06 school year as he moves from Cape Elizabeth to become the principal at Freeport High School. I note in here he says change can be daunting. It's also exhilarating as I will again look to develop a positive rapport with new students, parents, and lead another very professional staff. I would ask you to consider his resignation with regret.
We have to vote to accept this,
yes.
Right? Thank you. Is there a motion to accept Mark Tinkham's resignation?
So moved.
Thank you. Second? Thank you. Linda, any comments?
I wish him the best in Freeport. I know he's going to do a great job.
He is. He will be missed, and I applaud him moving on as a principal. All those in favor? 7-0.
Second resignation I have is from Karen Cronin, who is a speech language pathologist. She writes to Claire letting us know that she will be leaving to join her husband, who's accepted a new position in Massachusetts, which will therefore require a move of the family. So I am again seeking a recommendation to accept her resignation.
I have a motion to accept the resignation of Karen Cronin.
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Anne. Comments? All those in favor? 7-0.
And the third one was just came across my desk today is from Gene Cunningham. Gene is an educational technician 2 at Pond Cove. She is also resigning her position because of other commitments. And so I'd ask you to do the same with this one.
I have a motion to accept the resignation.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Rebecca, comments? All those in favor? 7-0. At this time, we're on item number 13. If there's any comments from the public. Seeing none, school board agenda requests. Do we have any requests besides the Tabor wording at this point for our next June meeting? Okay. Announcements of upcoming meetings. The extracurricular committee will meet tomorrow, Wednesday, May 10th at 2:00 in the Jordan Conference Room. Policy committee will meet Tuesday, May 16th, 12 noon, Jordan Conference Room. On May 11th, this Thursday, the planning committee will be meeting at 9:45 a.m. in the superintendent's office. The DLT meeting with school board and the Cape Elizabeth Educational Foundation will be in the Jordan Conference Room at 8:45 a.m. on Tuesday, May 16th. Personnel committee will be meeting on Monday, May 22nd, 1 p.m. in the superintendent's office. Our next school board workshop will occur Tuesday, May 23rd, high school library, and the topic will be our future directions plan. Finance committee will be meeting on Tuesday, May 30th, 12:30 p.m. This is with Connie Goldman in the superintendent's office. Communications committee, Thursday, June 1st, 3:05 p.m. in the Pond Cove Media Center conference room. And our next school board business meeting will be Tuesday, June 13th, 7 p.m. right here in town council chambers.
I just ask, Ann, I'm sorry, I've lost my mind here, but the policy committee says Tuesday, May 15th.
And you read 16th.
It is the 16th. She has a corrected copy. Everybody else has a corrected copy.
Well, you have the day of the week wrong, I think, though.
Okay, so it's Tuesday the 16th?
Tuesday, May 16th.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's all right.
Mine did, too, but then she read the 16th, so I was trying to figure out how she...
Sorry.
I picked that up.
Okay, do I have a motion to adjourn the meeting this evening?
So moved.
Thank you, Kevin. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
There's just one graduation.
Yes.